Gentlemen, very, very good morning to all of you. It's wonderful to be here for the Digital Governance Tech Summit. We've heard an excellent conversation between Anant and Mr. Amitabh Kant, really lifting our spirits with the kind of work that is being done. And Anant has presented us again a lot of insights as to how tech adoption, trust, etc., are required, are taking us forward, and how we need to all increase our tech intensity. It's a very special time, you know, after about 5 years of robust change, robust growth, a lot of efforts spread over the entire gamut of technologies under the Digital India program. I think we are poised to move into a different orbit altogether. On one side, we have tremendous strengths. On the other side, we have much, much higher aspirations today. And we need to have really lofty aspirations today. We have a strong IT services industry. We are good at using technologies, technologies that come from Microsoft, from IBM, from everywhere, from anywhere in the world. We are so good at using technologies, we actually help the rest of the world also in making use of technologies. It's time for us to move towards software products. We have been consumers of software products. We have not been producers of software products. It's time for India to move towards being a software product nation. We have had a tough time in the early part of this century in electronics. But in the last 5 years, we have once again seen a resurgence of manufacturing in India, starting with assembly of mobile phones. From about 6 crore mobile phones that were being assembled in 2014-15, you know, year on year we moved to 11.5 crore phones, to 17.5 crore phones, to 22.5 crore phones, and we closed the last financial year with assembly of 29 crore mobile phones within the country. You know, our entire consumption for the country is about 34 crore phones per year, 33 to 34 crore. We are now witnessing the assembly of 29 crore phones in India, and it's continuing to grow. Where next? I think it's very important. We have gone through the journey of import substitution. It's very important for us now to move into exports. As the mobile phones come in, as the electronics manufacturing shows a spurt, increasingly we are trying to bring the supply chain into the country. From mere assembly, importing all the sub-assemblies and then assembling it into mobile phones and other devices, it's very important for us, and we are right now moving in that direction seriously with policy, with many initiatives of bringing the sub-assemblies into India, of bringing component manufacturing into India. The impact of this is that once the PCB assembly and other sub-assemblies start getting done in India, components start becoming available in India, these go not just into mobile phones, these go into almost every electronic device. So this is the second major direction that we are trying to work on: exports and getting a complete supply chain, getting a complete electronics ecosystem. Why do I talk about electronics in this forum? Because these go hand in hand with the new technologies that are coming in, with IoT, with ubiquitous computing and 5G and IoT. It's going to be new devices, new device-led solutions that actually have the capability of taking us much, much further. We've had a good journey in implementing e-governance. In e-governance, a very large number of projects have been implemented in almost every area of our activity. Whether it is in agriculture with soil health card, with programs around seeds, distribution of fertilizers, pesticides, advice to farmers, whether it is in the area of passports, whether it is in the area of taxation with GSTN and many other supporting systems, Aadhaar, and large number of implementations almost in every single area of our activity by central government, by state governments, by local governments. A very large number of projects have been implemented, and we see something like 8 crore transactions happening on a daily basis today. In eTaal, if you open eTaal, you will see the number of transactions that are happening across the digital governance sector. Where do we go next? It's time to consolidate. The projects that started with a particular level of ambition have actually accomplished that ambition. A soil health program provides soil health cards to around 9 to 10 crore farmers every cropping season. Separate programs around seeds, fertilizers, land records, crop loans, crop insurance also fulfill their purpose. But most of them still remain silos. How do we bring them together? How do we provide a wholesome experience to the farmer? I am taking one example of agriculture. Initiatives of not just the Ministry of Agriculture, not just the central government, but across ministries, across center, state, local government, all of these need to come together to provide a complete set of harmonized services to farmers. How do we move towards that? I think public digital platforms, which Mr. Amitabh Kant referred to, is one of the important directions. We have experimented with public digital platforms. We have excellent results from the first few platforms that we have embarked on as a nation. Aadhaar is the very first ecosystem that I would describe as a public digital platform. It's not just a database. It is an ecosystem with a law in place, with regulatory framework in place, with an entity like UIDAI, with authorized service agencies, authorized user agencies, and fine-grained control of even the devices in which fingerprints or iris is taken. All of this has created an ecosystem. It is not the service which Aadhaar provides to citizens. It is the services which other entities provide to citizens and businesses using Aadhaar that actually makes the difference. It is an ecosystem. It is not a project. It's a platform. It's a public digital platform. With less than $2 billion of investment so far, the impact in terms of DBT savings alone is more than 10 times. If we count the impact this has had in onboarding of telecom subscribers, in onboarding of people who did not have bank accounts into the financial system, in many other areas of eKYC and, you know, even the attendance that we mark in government offices, the impact of this system is huge. It's a huge multiple of what we have invested into making it happen. The second example of a public digital platform is UPI. Again, Mr. Amitabh Kant referred to that. The Unified Payments Interface, a payments interface which actually serves as the middle layer between a conventional banking system and new age payment services. Payment services that are brought in place by Bheem reference app, by Paytm, by PhonePay, by Google, Tez, now Google Pay, and many of the banks. We have seen a huge spurt of digital payments in India. If we compare it with the number of transactions that happen making use of debit cards, you know, debit cards is the most prolific instrument available to us in the country. More than 90 crore debit cards are available with us. And they account for about 33 to 34 crore transactions in a month. UPI started just 3 years ago. By September 2016, it was notching up 1 lakh transactions per day. By January 2017, it had gone to 10 lakh transactions. By June of 2017, 100 lakh or 1 crore transactions in a month. By November of that year, 10 crore, again a tenfold jump. By September 2018, UPI registered 40 crore transactions in a month, overtaking an old and huge instrument of debit cards in terms of number of transactions. July this year, we have seen 82.2 crore transactions on UPI. It has, within three years of coming into existence, this is a public digital platform which has triggered huge activity, huge set of new age services, becoming by far the largest single instrument for digital payments. This is the kind of an impact that a public digital platform can have. In one of our neighboring countries, a huge country, there are two companies that actually dominate the world of digital payments, two private companies. In India, we have taken a different route, that of creating a public digital platform, creating the opportunity for banks, for public sector, for private sector to come in on top of a public digital platform, compete and create improved services. As a public digital platform, it remains open. It does not create room easily for monopolies. And at any point of time, a new entity is free to come in and disrupt those that are in place. I think it's very important to understand what public digital platforms can do for us. GeM and GSTN++, GSTN along with many other supporting systems are shaping to be also new public digital platforms. We need to now move forward and get similar national level public digital platforms in place in agriculture, in healthcare, in education, in logistics, in transportation, in energy, in environmental concerns, you know, where the government can move from being just a service provider to being a catalyst, to being an enabler, creating public digital platforms, writing the rules of engagement so that the private sector along with government can join hands and go on to provide much, much better services. Anything that we succeed with on a national scale, almost by definition, would get accomplished at price points which are extremely competitive across the globe. As C.K. Prahlad said, there's fortune at the bottom of the pyramid. The services that we design, the services that we roll out, the services that we succeed with, the products that we make for the bottom of the pyramid in India have an enormous opportunity of being successful across the globe. We have a wonderful demographic situation today, tremendous amount of talent. What's heartening is that some of the excellent institutions that used to be confined to a few major cities are now available in state after state. They are available city after city. IITs, IIMs, ICERs, IIITs, and even the leading engineering institutions in every state are getting to a level of maturity, level of much higher confidence. We are seeing BPOs spring up almost across the country in more than 100 small cities and towns. We are seeing centers of excellence take shape. We are seeing the tinkering labs start to have an impact. With the strengths we have, with the aspirations we are setting for ourselves, one of the most important resources for us, you know, where we have the capability today, the capability is recognized by a large number of multinationals which are present in India today for developing their services, for developing their products for the global consumption. So India has the capability. Where will the next generation of innovation, where will the new innovations, where will the new solutions come from? As Mr. Amitabh Kant also referred to this, in Silicon Valley, the problems they encountered, the problems they understood, they have been extremely good at coming out with solutions. They have the capability to come out with solutions. In areas like Silicon Valley, they are running out of problems to solve. The problems are best solved proximate to where the problems are. There are many other parts of the world where possibly there are larger number of problems than we encounter in India. But the capability to solve those problems is much lower. India is where the rubber meets the road. The capability of solving problems, the capability of combining knowledge in IT, an ecosystem in electronics, the presence of giants of India, along with the finest companies from across the world, and a large number of problems that are ready to be solved. The new technologies that are coming in, AI, blockchain, AR and VR, the new generation of manufacturing, the availability of large cloud-based services, the coming in of a software products ecosystem, all of these suddenly provide us with the capability of solving problems which could not be solved earlier. One example is language technologies. 22 official languages. Large language groups which still, if they know only their own language, Malayalis and Bengalis, they cannot have a conversation. And that's been a problem which we have lived with. Suddenly, AI and the new set of technologies that are coming in give us the possibility of actually solving this within 5 to 10 years. If we apply the new technologies to our problems, we'll be able to find solutions which we could not even imagine earlier. So the combination of capability, the combination of existence of problems that are crying to be solved, I think gives us a tremendous opportunity. And this is the direction in which we should see India moving over the next few years. This is what we have all to put our force and strength together. And this is a completely new India that we are moving towards. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak.
Thank you, Mr. Sahni, for sharing your insights with us.